knowledge or power. It is power. Number one, we are telling a lot of stories about our ancestors. That is just story. That has no power at all. Number two, we are reading in books and we are claiming for our ancestral heritage or pride, which is not going to come for rescue for today. That is history. Third thing is mystery, which we don't know. Fourth thing is knowledge, where we just know, but we don't know how to apply. Fifth is application, which is power. So we are having the other four dimensions, like information dimension we are having, mystery dimensions we are having in numbers. And stories and histories are uncountable. Everybody is chanting the glory of our land. And apart from all of these things, real benefit is power. Unless we see it in the form of power, we cannot use it for our development, for our protection, prevention against other, lot of other anticipated, prognosticated evils which we are going to face in this society in future due to a lot of other invasions, fusions and silent revolutions which are happening without any proper. In the olden days, there was military wars. Now there are lot of cultural war, cultural invasion war, then disintegration technology. There are innumerable panchatantras being handled by people, political and social entities. They are grouped to do lot of panchatantras, and they are doing smart and soft and sweet and shrewd wars by which the military impact of destruction is going to be brought. So unless it is developed into power by tapasya, by achara, by brahmacharya, by yajna, by means of dhyana and vididhyasana, by means of mass prayer or samuhika prarthana, these tools of religion, these tools of divinity, they should be handled, without which we cannot get anything. So I want somebody to start this institute, to commence at least with 100 pairs of people. We cannot take the children. They should be just conceived by a Vedic beginning. So that which is commenced, that which is conceived, that which is conducted, that which is carried and concluded by a spiritual or divine process, that is a perfect progeny. Unless we do such things, mere this type of description or dialogue or discussion or debate about samskaras, those things are just kindling our enthusiasm. Those things are to arouse our enthusiasm, to remind us about our past glory, so that we can dynamically contribute something for the development of the nation now. And coming to the conclusion, I want to say about the gist of all of this samskaras. Number one, first is garbhadana. I want to say there are two things. One is known as bioarchitecture. Second is known as theogenetic tailoring or theo-eugenetics. Now these people in science, they are saying eugenetics, something new. And this eugenetics is totally anti-ethical. In bioethics, they have cut up about this eugenetics, that it will create lot of social moral erosion, it will create lot of congestion in the society. But this type of eugenetics, theo-eugenetics, in which the parents, they do sankalpa for getting a good son, that is theo-eugenetics. Bio-architecture, I want to say it in a different platform, but still I want to just present it in a nutshell. Whenever a person is conceived, whenever an embryo has a conception, immediately Tvashta, Dhata, Prajapati, Vishnu, Saraswati, Ashwini, these are all the divine forces which are entering inside and holding the child. Just as a famous sculptor, a talented sculptor, he chisels the rocks, cows and polishes and brings the design, Tvashta, Prajapati or Vishwakarma, he enters inside the womb and by his connective will Sankalpa, he designs the child. That is Sadrishya, how much he should resemble the parents. Then Sankarya, must the resemblance be a fusion of both father and mother, remote relative, maternal relation, paternal relation, all of these options are considered with Vashta. Sadrishya means resemblance. Then Vyatyasya means difference. Vaiparitya means contradiction. Vaikalya means physically handicapped nature. Abhyadhikya means larger in size. Nayunya means absence of some organs. Atyalpya means, that is, non-regulated size reduction of organs. So size reduction of organs, size boosting of organs, then absence of some organs, absence of certain hormones and certain types of processes in the body, resemblance, difference, fusion of resemblance, everything is designed inside the womb by the bioarchitecture method by Tvashta Prajapati. So as we consider everything as divine, what is science and what is spiritualism? Seeing God even in simplest things is spiritualism. Seeing God even as something very simple is science. Everything, whatever the great thing it is considered to be, it is a natural selection. It is a phenomenon. It is its nature. It is by accident. That's what I told, the greatness of civilization, our civilization is just only one thing. There are innumerable other things, let it be. There is only one thing. There are four stages, significant stages in this world. One is creation of the world. Second thing is creation of life. Third thing is evolution of human race. Fourth thing is evolution of civilization. Our Shastra says that everything is a divine grant and they have been systematically made and configured. Whereas all the four things are answered by science as accident. It is an accidental evolution, it has accidentally exploded. Why it has come accidentally? Everything is accidental. How you can frame out the purpose of life? Ontology, basis. Axiology, how things are happening. Teleology, what is the purpose? Understanding, strong basis known as ontology. Understanding the strength of the process is axiology. Understanding a strong purpose or reason behind everything is known as teleology. If everything is accident, how you can do a lot of researches on accident things? How you can create incidental, intellectual, coordinating, cogent and coherent readings and research outputs in accidental basis? How you can do that? If everything is yadrucha, then how you can create some sort of sturdity, some sort of ground or consolidation? Everything, if everything is constructed in air castle, then how a person can reside in that? So, everything is based on a system. Observation is based on perception. Perception is based on organic precision. Organic precision is based on mental captivation. Mental captivation is based on intellectual coordination. Intellect is based on calculus. Calculus is based on mathematics. Mathematics is based on logic. It is based on science. That is based on philosophy. Philosophy is based on self-realization. Self-realization based on revelation. Revelation is based on divine immanence. So everything, even just the womb is designed and there is a babe and we are giving birth. So it is something considered to be a biological phenomenon which has no difference with the amoeba, paramecium, pig, dog, everything, etc. Then what is the purpose of human life and what is his sanctity and what is how he is a distinguishable? So that can be understood only by a divine thing, that is known as bioarchitecture. In bioarchitecture, as we believe that it is carved inside, it is capacitated inside, it is designed, directed and executed inside, there is a possibility for belief which can lead us to, which can lead us to prayer, which can lead us to divine sanction, which can lead us to different benefits which cannot be brought by science. As we believe and we execute, we can get some benefits which cannot be received by the non-executors and non-believers. But it should be practically done and proved by people. Without saying it in a mic or loudspeaker or in an auditorium, we must be having some sort of visible thing. Somebody asked me, most of the inventors, we say that knowledge comes from purity. Most of the inventors, they are all drunkards and they are all non-vegetarians. And there is this ativyapti and abhyapti. These people, those who are very much pure, observing lot of rituals, taking baths thrice a day, they did not accomplish anything which they did. So it is a gap between these people. These destined people, they did have a strong cognitive drill, abhyasa. Even though they are not directly connected with divinity, I have already told about different types of worship. Secret worship, sacred worship, systematic worship, later worship, latent worship, alternative worship and associated worship. If they are not worshipping, the relatives who worship. If today they are not worshipping, at the time of all day when nobody is there to help them, they worship God. And for others, they may say that they are not worshipping, secretly they will worship inside and they will ask the divine pardon. So this is there. And even if they are not directly worshipping God, they will be worshipping nature or loving human beings or doing something which is representing divine worship. So it is otherwise impossible. So the Western people, they did a lot of hard work or cognitive drill. And they did not access to the fundamental rules of knowledge. We are having all fundamental roots of knowledge, but we did not use that fundamentals, we did not expand that fundamentals to go for real innovative projects about the mysteries of the world. So, wherever there is a possibility of blending both the practical exercises of the West and the inherent and the innate or internal exercises or inner cognitive drill exercises of the East, whenever there is a blend, that is going to be a dance of the world. So, Garbhadana believes in eugenics. You can design a child, Arishtavira, Suvira, Bhavema. I want a militant child. I want a knowledgeable child. I want a productive child for my family. I want a child to rule the nation. So whatever you want to do, you can care for a Prajakama, you can care for a Vipra, you can care for a Dhanasampanna, you can care for an Indra. You can, you see, you know that even Devaki, Vasudeva, they have did prayers by which they got the God himself as a son. That's what I told in Venetology. If there is a possibility for getting even God as our child, provided we have the belief and patience, why can't we get God-like, God-shaped or God-intelligent